Praise God, dear heart. Thank you for joining me again today on the call-in deliverance session. I'm your host, Evangelist King. Remember, I make myself available every Wednesday and Thursday at 2 p.m. Eastern Standard Time. And you can call 720-820-1363. Enter participant code. Well, I'm sorry. No participant code if you call 720-820-1363. But if you're an international caller, then go to our webpage at freeconferencecall.com/wall/evangelistking and find your country dial-in number. Then you enter the SS code 335950. Again, if you call the one number 720-820-1363, you don't need to enter a participant code. But if you call the original dial-in number, which is 712-775-7031, that is when you have to enter participant SS code 335950. Also, dear heart, it's best before any session, and I try to make myself available on Wednesday and Thursday, but sometimes something may come up and I may not be able to make it. So it might be best to always, I say about 15 minutes, 10 to 15 minutes before 2 p.m. Eastern Standard Time, if you go to the webpage freeconferencecall.com/wall/evangelistking and look at the calendar to see if I'm indeed coming on for that day, because sometimes I may have emergencies that will come up and I may have to cancel, as like I did yesterday. So praise the Lord. So I see I have two callers on the line. So 0570-9412, call before you. So I'm gonna go ahead and bring 9412. Also 0570, if you have to hang up now, make sure you call back before I end that current session. Because if I end a session and nobody else online, then I usually go ahead and close out sessions for that day. I don't want to break in that recording, so that's the reason why I go ahead and close out sessions. So you make sure you call back if you have to hang up. So I'm going to bring 9412 online. Let me see here. I'm trying a new system here. I think you unmuted. Can you hear me now, 412?
Yeah, I can.
Okay. I'm on another system here. So.
Okay.
Okay. Now I'm hearing a strange noise. Is that coming from your area? Like something
yeah, that banging? Was my mother. That was my mother. I was calling on my mother. Hey, I want you to speak to her. Here she is.
Oh, you were calling on your mother's behalf.
Yeah. Hello?
Now, you sound way far away.
You say I sound far away?
Yeah. Am I on speaker? Am I on speakerphone?
Let me see.
If I'm on speaker...
There it goes. She took it off.
Okay, yeah. Take me off.
Now, can you hear me?
Yeah, I can hear it clear now. Okay. So what is your first name and the state you're calling from?
My first name is Barbara from Illinois.
Okay. Have you called before?
No, ma'am.
Okay. So how did you find out about me, Barbara?
My daughter did from one of the nurses that she worked with at the hospital.
Oh, so your daughter worked with a nurse at the hospital who knew about me, and she mentioned it to your daughter.
Her last night. Yeah, but yes, ma'am. Oh. She mentioned it to my daughter last night.
Okay, well, praise the Lord. Now, what is it, Barbara, you expect the Lord to do in your life?
I want a closer walk with God.
Okay, then that's something we have to do, but what is it specifically?
I want my inner as well as my outer, you know, cleaned. I want my family to have togetherness, to come before God, mm-hmm. for themselves, stop all this arguing and fighting and carrying on.
Okay, no, right. So we're talking about Barbara.
I want my health and strength back. Yes, we're talking about me.
Okay, we're talking about
I'm
Barbara
Barbara.
because, okay, because a lot of times
Well,
we want God to work in our family, but it starts with us first. So Barbara, what is it that you feel that is hindering your walk with the Lord?
I guess quite a few things.
Because we first must we
My
first must
husband, for one.
Okay, see, you're going back to what someone else is doing. No, we're talking about Barbara. Barbara wants a closer walk with God. Okay, so therefore, there's something in Barbara that is hindering her from walking closely with God. So what is it
I don't.
that is hindering you from being close to God? Not what someone else is doing. See, God's not going to hold us accountable based on how what people do to us. He gonna hold us accountable what we do to people. So that's the reason why we must confess to our own wrongdoings instead of confessing to someone else's wrongdoing. So what is it that
Okay.
Barbara needs
I'm
to
not
do?
doing any.
See, Barbara don't feel like she's doing anything wrong. It's just the
No, no, no,
people.
no. I
Okay.
do holler quite a bit, but that's
Okay.
because I work so hard, even with the pain, and I know the Lord is going to help me go through the pain that I have. But I have been doing a lot of hollering and that kind of stuff, which I've calmed down. I pay my tithe and my offering, my dues. I do all of this.
Let me ask you this,
I wasn't
Barbara.
always that close, but I'm getting closer. Yes, go ahead.
Let me ask you this. Now, how long have you been saved? How long you have turned your life around? Been serving the Lord?
I've always been with the Lord.
How long?
I
You
just
ain't
have not
always.
always been.
Not,
I haven't
no.
always been going to church,
No, that's not
but
true.
I've
Only one
always
who
had.
always been with the Lord is Jesus Christ Himself. The rest of us, we are
Okay.
sinners saved by grace. So when was it that Barbara admitted to God that she have sinned and disobeyed God, and now she want God to come into her heart and live His life in and through her? When did you do that? When did you say that to the Lord? When did you become godly sorry for your own wrongdoings against God and you wanted to serve the Lord with all your heart?
I've
When
asked
did
the
that
Lord if there's
happen?
anything that I've done knowingly or unknowingly to anybody that I apologize. But this has been for some years now.
Okay, again, let me ask you again, Barbara. When did you surrender or submit your life to Jesus Christ? When did you become godly sorry of your sins to God and ask God to forgive you and to come into your heart and live His life through you? When did you do that?
This has been about 5 years or more.
So 5 years or more, okay? When you did that, Barbara, did anyone ever take you through a deliverance? A deliverance where demons who was actually residing in your mind, your will, your emotion, and body that caused you to rebel against God? Did any anointed appointed servant command those spirits to come out of those areas? Did anyone ever do that to you? Or was you just merely prayed for?
I have different people praying for me.
Okay,
Is that what you're saying?
So they just prayed for you, but there was no confrontation. See, it was demon
Oh, no,
spirits
no,
that
no confrontation.
they'll come.
I
Now
haven't
I'm
had
talking
any
about,
confrontation.
no, listen, you not understand. No confrontation with the human being, but a confrontation where the servant of God confront the demons that took up residence in your mind, your will, your emotion, and body that caused you to rebel against God. They're the ones who should have been confronted. That is the confrontation I'm talking about. Not a confrontation. So no one ever,
I've never re
So no anointed appointed servant ever done that.
No.
Okay. That is why demons are in your mind. Even as I speak to you right now, Barbara, do you not know there are demons in your mind hindering you from even understanding the ways of God, the word of God? And when they are approached, they get defiant within your mind. Did you realize that?
No.
See, God wants you now again, like you said, you want your inner appearance to appear like your outer appearance. If I was personally meet you, you were seen to look like a pure and true woman of God who wouldn't even hurt a fly. That's what the outward look say. But inwardly, Barbara, there is hell in you. Those spirits are in you. And they really capture your mind. They got you in prison, your mind in prison, where you can't even comprehend or understand the ways of God. And that's because they never been confronted. So my question, Barbara, are you willing to allow the Lord to clean you up on the inside? And that means he's going to do some things in you that you're not even going to understand why he's doing it, because you don't have that understanding. See, that's why we must have to first humble ourselves. Before we can receive the mercy and grace of God, we must humble ourselves. And we must admit that, Lord, I am nothing without you. I'm nothing. I can't think.
And I do say that.
It's not just something you say. It's something what you mean from the heart. So when we mean it from the heart, then we'll be willing to accept God's instructions. So,
yes, ma'am.
So you never been delivered. You never, those demon spirit in you never been confronted. God going to set you totally free, Barbara. He going to set you free. And after he set you free, the Lord wants you to continue to humble yourself. Again, you're not going to understand everything. You're not at the moment. But if you trust God, you keep believing, keep seeking, trusting, knocking, meditating over his word, pondering over over the things that he have done and what he said, then you'll get more understanding of what other people were trying to tell you in times past, and you reject it all because you don't understand it. And that's because those spirits have got your mind captured. Okay?
Mm. Yes, ma'am.
Okay.
And what do I do?
So, God going to set you free. All he just wants you to do is to believe and to receive. Now, there is a religious spirit that's there, and there is a spirit husband that's there too. I don't know if your daughter ever mentioned to you about a spirit husband and what it is. It's a demon spirit that says in the spirit realm that you are its wife and it is your husband. Its intention is to destroy your destiny in Christ Jesus. This thing destroys human beings sexually. You know, it sleeps with a person. They have sex in the dream. And if they have to come in the likeness of a boyfriend of your husband or somebody you like, they would do that. They'll put on that appearance. But actually, you having sex with a demon spirit. You masturbate in the natural realm. The proof, one of the proof or evidence of it being a person's life, they masturbate. They masturbate. Okay, they have sex without marriage. Sex without marriage. A lot of times they marry 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 times. How many time it takes? That's how many times they marry. And this spirit does open the door to the spirit of anger. Spirit of anger is in that house too. When I say in that house, I'm talking about in you, your mind, your will, your emotion, your body. That spirit angry. Anger. That's the reason why you have a tendency to flare up at different people. And see, this is evidence that these spirits are inside the house, inside a person's mind, will, emotion, and body, because that's not the personality of the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit is gentle. He's gentle.
Yeah.
He's loving. He's caring. He don't even hold a record of any type of wrong done towards him. You know, that's why you have a tendency to go back and say what this person done, that person done. Why? Because you got that record. That record is there. Love doesn't do that. Love, who is God, does not keep record of wrongdoing. Does not keep that record. Yeah. But these demon spirits will keep record. Okay? Also, you know, as a woman of God, you have to keep yourself modest. And that means modest in appearance. We as women of God, we must keep our appearance modest. Our appearance cannot be fake, which is false. These days, women of God, even though they claim they love the Lord, but when you look at them, their appearance is fake. It's fake. It's not truth. And the Holy Spirit does not represent any fakeness or falseness. And how women of God now is representing fakeness and falseness is by wearing false things. You got your false hair, you got the false nails and blah blah blah, and
I don't wear any of that.
And even with women, may not have the false hair, but the style itself represents the king of darkness, and that's still falseness. That's fake. It's fake. It's not of God. So we have to really watch ourselves, okay? And the main thing, we have to stay humble. Make sure, now, Barbara, you have a problem with humility. I'm picking up in the spirit, you have a problem with humility. Again, there are going to be a lot of things that you're not going to comprehend, understand. And the Lord said, hush up. Don't say anything. Ask him. He will take you to his word and show you and lead you in all truth, because that's what his spirit does. Just don't automatically just blurt out and come against it or try to justify yourself. We have to stay low and humble. When we stay low and humble, remember the Lord said that he gives grace to the humble, but the proud, he resists. He will resist a prideful heart, a prideful spirit. Any type of pride, he will resist. Pride is a demonic spirit. That is a demonic spirit, okay? And the Lord will resist pride. Again, sometimes people say things and you don't agree. Don't be quick to say, I don't agree with that. That's pride. You can even pick it up in the sound of the voice. I don't agree with that. That's the spirit of pride. No, if you don't agree with that, you don't have to say anything. Say, Lord, I don't agree with that. They're wrong. Lord, I ask you to show them. Let them know that they wrong. That's how humility will act. Okay?
And that's what I've been trying to do lately, especially at church. When I answer a question or something like in Bible study, and then the same answer I said, somebody else said it the same thing, but a little different. And certain people will say, well, so-and-so said such and such and such and such. So lately, that is what I've been doing, is asking the Lord to send St. Michael to help me fight my battles instead of me speaking, because you are right. Usually flare up and say.
Just let it go. Just don't flare. That happened to me when I was a young girl. The same thing happened to me with my pastor. He didn't like me as a little young teenage girl. You know, he had Bible quizzes, and I looked forward to those Bible quizzes. I would spend hours and hours in the Bible searching for the answer, and God would always give me an answer, because I always would seek for it. So I remember this one Wednesday night, I gave an answer. He said, no, that's not it. And then another sister gave the very same answer. He said, that's right.
Yes,
and I
knew.
And I was like, that's what I said. But I didn't say anything. I just saw he was playing favoritism. But I didn't get angry.
Yes,
I just left that in the hands of God, because I knew that I was right. God sure gave me that answer, and that was his problem. I didn't jump up and say, I said the same thing. Why did you receive it from her and not me? I didn't do that. No. Well, no, because God gave me peace about the matter. And see, that's what humility, that's how humility acts. You know, God going to allow things like that to happen to us, Barbara, because we're going to be tested. Our faith is going to be tested. Okay?
And that's what it means when it says, set a guard over my mouth.
Set a guard over my mouth. That means that there's a time to speak and a time not to speak. There's a season for all things. The time to speak, time not to speak. Time to be quiet, time not to be quiet. And the Holy Spirit will always let us know. But when that spirit, that demon spirit of pride is in us, we always got to tell a piece, we say a piece of our mind. Again, that is not the workings of the Holy Spirit. But God is going to set you free. And now, I heard you say something a while ago. Is your background Catholic?
No, ma'am. It's spiritual.
Spiritual?
Spiritual. Yes, ma'am.
Spiritual. Because I know most Catholics always pray that God sends Saint Michael. So that's why I ask you, is your religious background Catholic?
No, ma'am. I believe in Saint Michael, Saint Peter, Saint Jude, Saint Raymond.
Saint
Jude. I believe in all the saints.
You believe in all the saints. So all the saints are with God now. That's where all the saints are.
Right.
But do you not know God only sent one person to be our helper, our comforter? He's that's where he's our life coach. He's our guide. Whatever we need him to be, he's our intercessor. Whatever we need him to be, he's with us. It's Jesus through and by his
ma'am.
Spirit, the Holy Spirit. Jesus by his Spirit, the Holy Spirit. God's not going to send St. Jude. He's not going to send St. Michael because they are with him. That is not their responsibility. But it's the Holy Spirit's responsibility. So if you're going to call on a person to help you, let it be the person of the Holy Spirit. Because he's the only one who can help you in every area of your life. He's the only one.
Yes, ma'am.
So if you can look on him as being just as real as St. Michael, St. Thomas, and St. Jude, which is even more real because he is Jesus in spirit, you will be an awesome woman of God.
When I read my Bible every day, I always have him in front of me. I have a praying hand with him in the inside. On the top of my TV stand, I have him all over the house.
Now, you say, so, Lover, you say you have him all over the house. So you got different idols all over statues.
No, Jesus.
You're talking about the
picture.
Now, you're talking about the picture of Jesus. You're talking about, okay, no, uh-uh. You need to get rid of those pictures because those pictures, that is not Jesus. Okay? That picture itself is not the image of Jesus. Jesus lives in our heart. We know by faith that Jesus never leaves or forsake me. I don't have to have pictures of Jesus on my wall to help me to realize that he's always with me. He said we live by faith. It's only faith in his word. Now, you sure there's not a Catholic background in your family lineage?
No, ma'am. No Catholic.
Well, how did you just start doing these things? Because it falls under Catholicism.
This is the way it's been all my life. My mother was a minister.
She wasn't a Catholic. Somebody was a Catholic back, because there is a religious spirit there. Yeah, somebody was a Catholic back in your family lineage, because. Like, what I'm hearing, it stems from being a Catholic, Catholicism. Yeah. See, Jesus wants you to live and walk by faith. Again, I don't need a picture of Jesus in my bedroom. I don't need a picture of Jesus in my kitchen or my bathroom. Where I go, to remind me that Jesus never leave me or forsake me. I know by faith, I believe in his word that he said he would never leave me. He never forsake me. And that's what you have to do. You have to get rid of all of those pictures, and if you have those idols that help you to remember that Jesus is always with you. Demon spirits will take and live in those objects. Next thing you know, you start seeing Jesus, the picture of Jesus' eyes, his maybe winking at you, and you be like, did you see that? Jesus winked at me. And that is not Jesus. That is a demon spirit. Demons do tricks like that. They do tricks like that. If you start worshiping images and idols, they would get in those things, and they would trick a person. But God wants you, Barbara, to walk and live by faith in his word. And in his word alone, that you walk and live by faith. In his word alone. You don't need no thing to remind you that Jesus never leave you or forsake you. No thing to remind you that Jesus lives forevermore. You know these things by faith. Faith in his word, because he said it in his word, and you believe it. Okay? That's what the Lord wanted you to do. Because if you don't, the Lord just said, Satan will put sickness in your body. He'll put sicknesses in your body.
I have it.
That's right. That's what the Lord just said. He'll put sickness in your body because you're not walking by faith in God's word. You know, you have to, we have to go by faith in his word. He died for your healing. He died for my healing. We have to lay claim to that. And how we lay claim to it is by faith, believing. I don't need those pictures of him. I don't know how he looked. Nobody know how he looked. But back then, they didn't even have no cameras. So I don't need those things, because I know he lives and he lives forevermore. I know he loves me. He cares for me, because he died for me. And then when you start believing God, then the devil have to go and take his sicknesses with him. See, those sicknesses, Jesus was not the one who gave you sick. Why is Jesus going to take your sickness and turn around and give you sickness back? He ain't going to do that.
He didn't give me sickness.
Satan gave you those sicknesses. He took advantage of your lack of knowledge. But now God have opened up your mind, given you this knowledge, and you hold on to his word. Hold on to his word that by his stripes you were healed. He was bruised for your sins, your transgression. The chastisement of your peace was upon him. So therefore, you don't have to take all of this and you say, Jesus, thank you for saving me, for delivering me, for healing me. And you praise him, you worship him, you exalt him. You don't even look on what your eyes are seeing or what your body is experiencing. Say, that's an illusion, that's a lie. I'm going by the word of Jesus. I'm going by what Jesus have done. And you just keep your eye, your mind fastened, glued, stayed on him. That's what we have to do, because Satan always going to throw his illusion, because he knows we are type of people that go by our sight and what we feel. Mm-mm, we got to learn to go by faith in God's word that he cares. Praise his holy name.
That's why he kept my baby for such a long time. When Nan said she wouldn't make it, God said she will, and she did.
And she did, didn't she? And she will, because she will until Jesus say it's time. She got a course to take.
She's paralyzed and been that way since she was 14 months old, and they didn't think she'd live to be 5. Mm-hmm. But God said, yes, she will. And she's 32 now. She's still paralyzed and on a ventilator, but she is the most happy, sweetest thing you ever want to see.
And you keep trusting God, because God is a miracle-working God.
And I do, and that's why I know he keeps her.
Because he can raise her.
I know he keeps her.
He can raise, he'll raise her to confound the wives. Everybody who say that it's not possible he's going to come find them. Because sometimes children's deliverances are tied up into their parents' deliverance. It's tied into their parents' deliverance. So after your deliverance, Barbara, you just keep on trusting God and holding on to his word that he can resurrect your daughter's dead body. And she's not physically dead, but because she can't move, it's acting as though it's dead. So he can give life to that body where she can move her body about. But you're going to have to continue to trust him. And if you got all those pictures in her room of Jesus, if you got those pictures and different items of St. Thomas, Michael, or whoever in her room, the Lord said, take them things out. Take them things out. Go to the Christian bookstore, Barbara. Go to the Christian bookstore. They got nice pictures of the Word of God. Now they have scriptures, and you can post it all over her wall. So when she look up, she reminded of the Word of God, and she can speak and quote and read to herself or out loud, whichever one she want to do, the Word of God. So that way she'll be reminded of God's Word. And next thing you know, one day you could be in the bed and she's walking up and out of that room. So we have to do things like this to help build our faith, our trust in God. See, we can be, parents can keep their child bound and don't even know they keep them bound. Why? Because, especially if a child is confined to a room because they're having the wrong things around them, wrong things on their wall. Because when they look up, they're not reminded of the Word of God. She needs to be reminded of the Word of God. Just put it everywhere. Put it everywhere. Just allow the Holy Spirit to use.
Go to the bookstore and get Word of God.
The Christian bookstore. You're going to look around at the Christian bookstore, and the Holy Spirit is going to point out to you to get this particular scripture. Get that particular scripture. Because they have it all on the wall, nice pictures of the Word of God, and the Holy Spirit gonna pick and choose. He's gonna choose, and he's gonna tell you which one to get. Put it on her wall. Same thing, you know.
Yes,
same thing with word, with music or whatever she listening to. You need to make sure she getting the Word of God in her ears. I mean, there's some ministry that have healing scriptures. They just play it. Just play that healing stretch in the room over and over so that the Word of God can get embedded into her hearing. That's one ministry. I got to ask my husband, because he will, a few months ago, he was listening to this ministry where he was ministering healing stretches. And it's very anointed. So I'm going to ask Roger for it, and I'll take in, I got your number, and I'll take in call you to let you know where to find that ministry. And I think it's on YouTube too. Matter of fact, I believe it is, and I get the link from him, and then you can just pull it up and just let it play so that the Word of God can saturate her environment, her atmosphere. Anointing just flow. Because I was sick in the hospital about a few years ago, and Lord led me, as I was in my room, I played nothing but worship and also the Word of God. I wouldn't let nothing else be in that room. And this one particular time, I was really bad off. It's just a blessing of God, and I'm alive. And I turned to this ministry, and I could feel the anointing coming off the television and entering right into my body. I felt that life coming from the television, from the man of God, and entering right into my body. At that time they were doing worship, and then they were doing deliverance session. That was Prophet TV Joshua deliverance sessions. And I kept that on in my room, and this, like I said, this particular day I was really bad off. And the Lord told me to leave it on. I left it on, and I literally felt when the wise men was doing deliverances on different people, I literally felt the power of God coming from that television and entering into my body. And then ever since then, it was like life. I felt so much better. so much better. And whatever that problem was, it disappeared. So we have to be careful what we allow to come on in our rooms or in our home through the television, because either it's the Holy Spirit or demon spirit that's going to come through that television stream, whether a person believe it or not. So this is what you need to do for your daughter as well. So Barbara, what I'm going to do, I'm going to pray for you, and I want you to receive by faith. Just like me, I did not know what was going on in my body before the Lord set me free, but I believed what he said, and I opened myself up to receive what he said. And by doing so, he delivered me from an unclean spirit in which I was clueless that was living inside of me. So it was his, because I humbled myself, he was merciful and gracious in setting me totally free. Okay, so you just receive. You may not understand now, but if you keep submitting yourself to the Lord, you will understand later, and you will say, oh, I see what Evangel King was saying now. Okay? Because God wants to set you totally free. So you just receive in Jesus' name. So, Father, in the name of Jesus, I thank you for this opportunity to minister your grace and your mercy to your daughter, Barbara. I thank you, Father, that it's Barbara's time to shine, to bring forth your glory upon this earth, Father. Father, I thank you that every plan, every purpose, every ideal that you have for her, it shall come to pass and bring in your son glory upon this earth, Father. Father, I thank you, Father, for confusing all of them, Father, who had given up hope on this family. Thank you, Father, that their hope is in you. I thank you, Father, for this reason, Father, for such a time as this, you shall be glorified in their life. And I ask you to continue to give Barbara revelation of who she is in your son, Jesus, and also who Jesus is in her. I thank you, Father. Father, we want to thank you for being on this conference line with us, because you said when there are two or three gathered together in your son's name, you're right here in the midst with us. And whatever we bind and loose on this earth, Father, you will bind and you will loose in the heaven. So, Father, I thank you for cleaning, thoroughly cleaning your house this day for true worship. So I take authority in the mighty name of Jesus. And I command you, spirit husband, you've been hiding yourself from her. And in the name of Jesus, I command you to take your load, pack your load, and get out of God's house. Every spirit, you are not of the Holy Spirit, I command you in Jesus' mighty name to come out of her mind, you come out of her will, you come out of her emotions, and you come out of her body now in the mighty name of Jesus. Holy Ghost, fire, burn. Burn, Holy Spirit. Burn all manner of darkness and evils that's lurking and hiding dormantly in her mind. Burn by your fire. Burn everything in her mind that exalts itself against the knowledge of God. Burn, Holy Spirit. Burn in Jesus' mighty name. Set her mind completely ablaze in the mighty name of Jesus. Holy Ghost, fire, burn. Burn all manner of darkness that's lurking and hiding in her will. Holy Ghost, fire, burn, 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 burn everything in her will that is exalting itself against the knowledge of God. Burn, Holy Spirit. Burn in Jesus' mighty name. Holy Ghost, fire, burn. Burn all manner of darkness that's lurking and hiding dormantly in her emotion. Burn by your mighty fire. Burn everything in her emotion that exalts itself against the knowledge of God. Burn, Holy Spirit. Burn in her emotion. Burn, burn all manner of darkness and evil in her emotion. Give her a clean flushing, a clean sweeping by your mighty fire. In Jesus' mighty name, Holy Ghost, fire burn. Burn all manner of darkness and evils that's lurking and hiding dormantly in her body. Burn, Holy Spirit. Burn everything that exalts itself against the knowledge of God in her body. Burn, Holy Spirit. Burn, burn everywhere on her body that is a opening. Burn everywhere on her body that is a mark known or unknown to her. Burn, Holy Spirit, burn in her belly. Burn all manner of snakes and eggs that's dormantly lying there. Burn, Holy Spirit. Burn in her womb, in her uterus, in her fallopian tube. Burn, Holy Spirit. Burn, 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 burn down in her mouth. Burn up her nose, in her nostrils. Burn in her eyes, in her ears. Burn, Holy Spirit. Set her body completely ablaze, Holy Spirit, by your fire. Burn all manner of darkness. Burn, Holy Spirit, that's lurking and running and hiding in her body. Burn, Holy Spirit. Don't leave no area or compartment untouched by your fire. Burn, Holy Spirit. Burn in Jesus' mighty name. Continue to give her a clean flushing, clean washing in Jesus' name. By faith in the name of Jesus, I take the scissors of God and I cut and detaches her from that ungodly covenant of idolatry and witchcraft and even religion. I disconnect her in the name of Jesus from every spirit marriage in the spirit realm. I disconnect her from every spirit family in the spirit realm. I disconnect her from every spirit husband in the spirit realm. I disconnect her from every spirit child in the spirit realm. For the blood of Jesus destroys the covenant. The blood of Jesus destroys that contract. The blood of Jesus separates, detaches her from you. The blood of Jesus destroys all manner of darkness in Jesus' mighty name. Thank you, Father, for dispatching your angels. And grab every spirit that's not of you and send them where you desire to send them. In the mighty name of Jesus. Holy Ghost fire, continue to set ablaze. Continue to set ablaze. Continue to burn. Burn in her mind. Burn in her mind. Burn in her mind. Burn, burn, burn. In her emotion. Continue to burn in her emotion. Continue to burn in her will. Continue to burn in her body. Flush out all manner of sickness that the enemy had planted there. Burn, Holy Spirit. Burn in Jesus' mighty name. In Jesus' name. Cleanse her blood, Holy Spirit. Burn in her bloodstream. Burn, burn, Holy Spirit. Purify her blood by the blood of Jesus. In Jesus' mighty name, Barbara, you be free in your mind. You be free in your mind. Be free in your mind in Jesus' name. You be free in your will. You be free in your emotions. And you be free in your body to serve the Lord thy God. In him only does you serve. In spirit and truth, be free in Jesus' mighty name. Father, I ask you now to fill Barbara. Don't leave a void or vacant, but fill her with your spirit. Fill her mind, fill her will, and fill her emotion with your spirit, Father, in Jesus' mighty name. Now, Father, I pray for Barbara's house. Holy Ghost, fire, go search and destroy at Barbara's house. All manner of darkness that's lurking, hiding, and running right now. Go in every room and burn all manner of darkness hiding in the crevice, the cracks, the corners of the room. Even go in the bedrooms right now. Burn over the bedroom, under the bedroom. Burn, Holy Spirit, under, over the bed, around the bed, between the sheet, between the mattress, on top of the mattress. Burn, Holy Spirit. Holy Ghost, fire, search and destroy all manner of darkness hiding behind the picture that happened in the cracks and crevices of the picture frame. Burn, Holy Spirit. Don't leave no space untouched, Holy Spirit, but burn by your mighty fire all manner of darkness in Jesus' mighty name. Even go outside the house. Burn over the house, around the house, under the house. Even burn under the ground, Holy Spirit, where objects have been planted under the ground. Burn, Holy Spirit. Burn those evil objects in Jesus' mighty name. Thank you, Father. Fill that house with your presence. Fill that house with your spirit, Father, in the mighty name of Jesus. Thank you, Father, for setting your daughter totally free that she can serve and worship you in spirit as well as truth. Thank you, Father. Let her feel your love, your compassion, your warmth, Father, in Jesus' mighty name. Thank you, Father, in Jesus' name. Barbara, you are free to worship the Lord God spiritually and truthfully. You are free in Jesus' mighty name. Continue to praise him, worship him. Continue to magnify him, exalt him. Let your conversation always exalt and magnify him. Speak only of his goodness. Speak only of his grace and his goodness. When the enemy tries to get you to speak on anything other than his grace and his goodness, you rebuke the enemy, say, no, in the name of Jesus, I refuse to speak on anything other than praising and exalting my Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. It is done. You are totally, totally free in Jesus' mighty name. You make sure you, you know, obey what God said about those images and those idols.
Because, I'm going to take them down.
Yeah, Lord said, that's not him. And it's not him, you know. Like I said, if we use common sense, if you look it up and see when cameras came into existence, Jesus was not even born on this earth yet. They didn't have cameras back then like we got cameras now. We could take a snapshot of a person and keep it for thousands of years, and then we'll see how that person looked. Well, even back then, when Jesus walked the earth, they didn't have cameras. So no, those pictures are not the Lord. Just like with pictures of Mary, that's not Mary, you know. So we have to live and walk by faith in God. It's done in Jesus' name. And again, Barbara, if you continue to magnify the Lord, speak on his goodness, and let your daughter hear the words of God coming up through you, it builds her faith, her trust in God. And then one day when you're not even thinking about it, she's going to jump up out of that bed. She'll jump up out of that bed. Because there's many that God's going to bring through repentance through her. It's like the man born blind. The disciples want to know, ask the Lord, who fault was it? The parent that called this man to be born blind? The Lord said, neither one. They thought maybe it was the sin of the child or sin of the parent. The Lord said, neither one. It was because of the will of God. Because God had a great work that he was going to do through Jesus when he healed that, cast that spirit of blindness out of him. With many souls,
yes,
saw that act, and they came to the Lord, and they were saved. It helped their faith in God, and they were saved. Same thing with your daughter. You know, keep trusting him. Keep trusting him. You know, keep trusting him. If we say we have faith in God, there should be some works to prove our faith in God. And you say you believe God, but you're going to have to show that you believe him by speaking words of faith. By doing acts of faith. You see, faith is the only thing that pleases God. Faith is. If we don't believe God, then we automatically do not please him. He told his disciples, said, you only believe me because I let you see me. But he said, more blessed are those who believe and they have never seen me. Now that puts a smile on Jesus' face when he look at us who have never seen him. But yet still we choose to believe him, that he is who he say he is. Pray. And if we truly believe, that he is who he say he is, then we will speak it. We'll speak those words of faith. We will act those words of faith, because what the heart believes, the mouth will confess to what the heart believes. So it's not just in merely, you know, just saying it. No, this belief comes from the heart. So God wants you to continue to believe him, praise and magnify him. So Barbara, as I was praying for you, what were you experiencing as I was praying for you?
It seemed like I felt better.
Mm-hmm.
It seemed like I don't know, like something with my mind, because I know the devil's been messing with my mind.
Mm-hmm.
You know, making me forget all the time where I'm going, what I'm supposed to be doing.
Mm-hmm.
I always ask the Lord, you know, that I revoke the devil in the name of Jesus, because I know he messes with me all the time.
Well, he's gone now, because if you notice, I kept putting emphasis on the mind, because I knew that's where the stronghold took up residence. Even though the stronghold was over your whole body, but it really took up a deep residence in your mind. And that's the reason why you hear me put so much focus on the mind. And the Lord, he grabbed them out. He snatched them out. That darkness is no longer in you. It's no longer in you. So you stay submitted to God. Now that thing going to try to tempt you so you can open the door and let it back in. Lord said, only you can open the door and let it back in. Only you. So the Lord said, what you have to do is stay submitted to him. Keep your mind stayed on him. If you see you're about to say something, got no business, you say, you're the lie devil. Because those words are not in my heart and they're not in my mind. This is you. I rebuke you in Jesus' name. And then you start magnifying the Lord. Exalting the Lord, worshiping the Lord, because the Lord, he done it. He snatched those spirits out of your mind, your will, your emotions, and your body. So you share with others the great things God has done for you. You share this goodness of God. You share. Don't hold back this testimony, Barbara. Your complete and total deliverance is wrapped up in your testimony. We overcome Satan not just by the blood of the Lamb, but also the word of our testimony. As you share this goodness that God has done for you, it frees you more and more, and it is helping someone else. They need to hear it so that they can be encouraged that God did it for you, he will also do it for them. So you share in Jesus' mighty name. Okay? Amen. Okay?
Amen. Yes, ma'am, because they have prophets all the time at church. But you can't never believe them because one say this, another say something else with the same people and stuff. Mm-hmm. So, you know, it's not right.
That's why we have to get into the Word of God, study, meditate with the right reason now to live by every word that comes out of God's mouth. That must be the reason why we study the Word of God, so that we can know what pleases God. And then the Holy Spirit will give us revelation of what we read and understand what we read. And then when Satan, false prophets and teachers get up and speak, then you test the spirits to see whether they are of God, and you will see from the Word of God, nope, that is not the Spirit of God, and you don't receive it. You just go on about your business, but you don't receive it. Okay?
And that's what I've been doing too, because I know it's not true.
Amen. So whoever that young lady was that shared my ministry with you, if you see her again, tell her Evangelist King said thanks for being obedient to God, because your freedom is credited to her account also, not just my account, but to her account, because we have a heavenly account. And our heavenly account, God knows everything that we do for him. That's why he said nothing that we do for him, everything that we do for him, it will last forever, because he notes it in heaven. It's noted. The angels write it down. So we have a heavenly account. So let her know that it's a credit to her heavenly account as well. That's why the Lord told us to share the goodness of God. Because when we share the goodness of God, it's credited us to our heavenly account, what we done. And we actually won't Barbara, won't know the full impact of what we done until we meet the Lord. He said, come here, let me show you something, Evangelist King. That's what he'll call me, because he knew that's what people knew my name on earth. And he's going to show me, and he told me that he said, I'm going to show you, and I'm going to be absolutely shocked. It did that? What? We're going to be surprised. That's why we should compare ourselves to another servant of God, because we don't really truthfully know the real impact of what we do for God until we meet God. You know, may get to heaven. Now you may see a minister now, and you see he's doing so much for the Lord, and you're like, well, I'm not doing what he's doing, so I'm not doing much. Then you get to heaven, and you look at your heavenly account, and you see in your heavenly account, you have more than what this minister that you admire when you was on earth, you have more in your heavenly account than he have in his. And you're going to be like, what, Lord? I thought he was doing way more than me. Lord said, no. I don't look on men like mankind does. So that's why we shouldn't be comparing ourselves with nobody. If we're going to compare ourselves with Jesus Christ.
Praise his holy name. But God do look upon when you do tithes and offerings, doesn't he?
Yeah, he does. But at the same time, he give you wisdom that you don't give tithes and offerings to everybody, in and everybody. Because if you don't see the fruit of God in that ministry, the work that ministry does, if the fruit of God is not in that ministry, that is not good ground. So when you plant your seed, which is your tithes and your offering, into that ministry, and that ground is dead ground, well, then you ain't going to see no type of increase off of that. You'll be wondering, well, I tithe, well, why did this happen? Because you planting your offering and your tithes into the wrong ground. I don't care if it is your church for 5, 10, 20 years. If they're not doing the things of God where you don't see the fruit of God's spirit in operation, souls have been saved, souls have been delivered, the widows have been taken care of, they seeking to help orphans, they're all about helping the needy. If you don't see that in that ministry lifestyle, then you don't plant your seed there. Because just like in the natural realm, if you go planting some seed into a ground that's not fertile, well, you just lost your seed. And that's why a lot of people is not seeing the result, financial result from God as they desire, because they plant it in their church because they say, I've been in this church for 5, 10 years. This is my pastor, this is my church. But no, look at the work. Is your pastor doing the work of God? Because number one, that ministry belongs to God. Is God showing forth his presence in that ministry where you see the works that when Jesus that you read about in God's word? If you don't see those works in your church, no, you about to be planting your seed there. It ain't going nowhere because you're planting into dead ground. I know we've been taught put your tithe in the church that you go to. No, that's not true, dear heart. No, that pastor's saying that because he wants that them tithes and them offering. His eyes ain't on the Lord and provide his need. His eyes on his members' tithes and offering to provide his needs. So you're going to hear him say, you're supposed to put your tithe, plant your tithes where your church is. No. Well, if you put your tithes where your church is, but yet still you go to another ministry where God is has manifested his presence, and you getting saved, you getting delivered, you get healed. Matter of fact, you always going to them and you getting healed, but yet still you putting your tithes and your offering to this ministry that ain't doing nothing. But yet still, when you need that spiritual nourishment, you go to that other ministry. Come on now, you need a thing. Hold up. Now, I'm prospering spiritually, but I'm not prospering financially. Well, where are you putting your tithe? Where are you putting your offering? But you prospering spiritually. Well, who are you going to for help? Well, I go to this ministry, and God really helps me. Well, that shows you that's good ground. Well, where are you putting your tithe? Well, I plant my tithe in my church. But you know what? I'm still having a problem. The enemy is taking every penny I got. Well, they tell you you planting your tithes into dead ground. So you need to do something about that.
I haven't put my tithes and offering mostly into this ministry, Pastor Peter Popoff. Have you heard that one?
Oh, you see, your tithes are offering to Peter Popoff.
And I was also to David Caruso.
I kind of heard the name, but I'm not for sure with that ministry. And how long have you been planting tithes there? At each one of them?
This is going on the second year.
And now, ain't that something? Now, you plant your tithes and offering in those two ministries, okay? But yet and still, right. you need spiritual support. You need spiritual help. So if you plant your tithes and offering there and they receive, where it should be, you should have been able to call them also to receive spiritual help as well. Because the Holy Spirit
yes, ma'am, they do, and they mm-hmm. both say something similar to what you're saying. Is that the devil has a hold?
But did they allow the Holy Spirit to use them to confront those demons, to call those demons out by name? That's a confrontation. When you call a person out by name, you are confronting them. Did they confront those demons? Not just give you the information, because quite naturally, the information is simple. You've been tormented. Best by listening to you, oh yeah, you've tormented. But the resolution is confronting those demons in the name of Jesus by faith and commanding them to come out. Did they do that instead of just giving you that information?
They call themselves.
They say they do.
Mm-hmm. Mostly it's by letters.
By a letter. You don't confront Satan through him by no letter. He tries that with me sometimes with chatting, and I say, look, I don't check. Check is not effective when it comes down to deliverance. There must be a verbal confrontation. You do not do it by letter. No. This is personal. This is personal. So I leave it up to you and God. You plant your tithe, your offering, wherever you want to. But if you want increase, all I'm telling is you got to change your soil. You got to change your ground. The ground that you plant your tithe and offering into is not good ground, not good soil. Even a farmer knows that when he plants seeds in a field, he'll know increase. Then he examined his soil and he sees it's not good soil. He said, I got to change my ground. I got to change my soil. And that's what you have to do as well. Okay.
Okay.
Yes, so man. Praise the living God. You know, the Lord shows me a lot through some people. Because I get it all the time. People, you know, saying about their finances. And the Lord tell me, said they're not planting the tithes and offerings in good ground. So what they do, they end up calling Evangelist King. And then spiritually, God heals them, saves them, delivers them. But when it comes down to their tithes and or offering, they go plant it somewhere else, and then they end up not getting blessed. And they come caught. Then they'll send me another email. Evangelist King, could you pray for my finances? And I be like, Lord, when will your children ever leave? Learn that they're gonna have to change the ground, change the soil in which they are planting. I even had this one young girl. She kind of did the same thing, and so God always have mercy. And I had mercy upon her, and so I pray that God bless her with a better paying job, because she had more than enough, and God did. He blessed her with a great paying job, which had more than enough. And the devil did not like it. See, when the Lord blesses us with a job, Satan don't like it. So he'll try everything in his power to take that job away from us. And he did with that girl. And she started planting her seed into wrong ground. Next thing you know, that pastor told her, you know, she wanted her to be in more time in the ministry. And that girl quit the job that God has given her.
No, she didn't.
Yes, she did. God gave her that job. Even though she got another job, but that job is not better than the one she left, because God gave her that job. She was making way more money. She didn't have to worry about anything. Anything.
Lobby.
And what's going to happen? Lord, tell me what's going to happen. About another 6 months to a year, I'm going to receive another message with her, from her. Evangelist King, could you pray for me? Come on, my dear heart. You know, if God bless you in a ministry, and And there's evidence that God is with that
has
ministry.
Blessed
and then
you.
That
right.
God through that ministry has blessed you, it has helped you in the time of your need. But yet and still, when it comes down to your finances, oh no, I'm going to give this finances to my pastor, to my church. And you know, and you look at your church and you see they're not doing the work of God. There's no fruit of God's work in that ministry, but yet still you plant your financial seeds there. You just plant your seed into a dead ground. I don't care if you've been going to that church 50 years. It's dead ground, and you're not going to prosper financially. Prosper financially. You're not, because you're planting your seed in that dead ground. Praise
yes,
the living
yes.
God. God gives
yeah,
us wisdom.
I need praise and praise for my financial as well as my, I guess, as well as my everything, but you just did my everything.
Amen.
My baby's van broke down. I need a new van
see?
For her.
See?
Handicap van, not just a van.
Yeah,
van,
yeah.
A handicap
right, right.
Van.
You need a specialized van, and that runs into the bus. That runs into money.
Yes, ma'am.
So
yes,
now
ma'am,
you know
does.
This truth. You know this truth, Barbara. So you plant your tithes and offering based on this truth that God has given you to the ministry that He leads you to.
You
which
have
would
a
be
ministry
which
that you collect
which,
that?
Which would be good ground. And then as you are faithful to Him in giving Him the first of your increase, then He's going to be faithful to you, and you just will receive a brand new van, handicap van for your daughter. God will work on someone to purchase one for you. God does things like that. He does things like that.
Yes,
but
we have to
be faithful to Him and trust Him in that He lead us to plant our financial seed in the ministry of His choosing, not the ministry of our choosing. Okay? Now, to answer your question, you know, I am a 501(c)(3) tax exempt organization, and you just go to the website, thechildrensmite.org, and I have a donation button there. And whoever want to donate. Now, I'm not telling you this so you can donate to me. I'm telling you this
no,
so that you
not.
Can so you can donate to the ministry that God Himself have chosen, where that ministry
right.
has allowed Him to act through His Holy Spirit in helping
yes,
His
ma'am.
Children. You see, that's me and whoever else God have raised upon this earth. He wants you to stop putting your money into dead ground. That's the main thing.
Yes, ma'am.
Don't plant it in the dead ground because there's no increase. That's why you haven't received any increase. They are receiving increase every time you send them fund, and that helps them, but it's not helping you. Okay?
Right.
All
yes,
right.
Ma'am.
So you stay blessed in Jesus' name. If you ever need to contact me, just have your daughter go to my website and my email address is on my website, thechildrensmite.org. And soon as I can, I will respond to your email, okay?
Okay, she's going to write it down for me now. Hold on.
Mm-hmm.
Hello.
Okay, yeah. Just the website, thechildrensmite.org. And click on Contact Us, and you can see the email address. And also, you'll see a donate button as if the Holy Spirit lead her to give to the ministry. Okay?
Yeah, I see a lady from the job. I looked on the site. I looked
mm-hmm.
On the YouTube and saw Children's Mic.
Mm-hmm.
Some of your videos.
Mm-hmm.
So when
yeah.
she go on to childrensmic.org,
right.
find a donate button.
Donate, or and then there's a contact us button, and you can see the email address or submit that general request form.
Okay, a request
all
form.
Right. All right, now, you all stay blessed in Jesus' name, okay?
Okay, now, how often can you call? Like, I call for my mother, and I like to call and speak to you as well.
Well, the problem is I have so many calls and so much other responsibility that it's hard for me to return calls. So that's the reason why for deliverance sessions, I make myself available Wednesday and Thursday at 2 p.m. So
Wednesday and Thursday, I can call you back.
Well, I prefer if it's a general conversation, not to, but because those times are deliverance session. But what you do is you go to that website, and when you click on contact us, you'll see a general submission form, and you can fill that form out and submit it, and you can say, Vanessa King, this is Barbara from Illinois, daughter, my mother, and I'd like to speak with you. And then I'll get it, and I'll print it out. And soon as I have some available time, then I'll call you back.
Oh, okay.
Okay.
Well, I appreciate you taking time to speak to my mother, because really needed it.
You're welcome. You're welcome. She's such a sweet lady.
Okay, thank you.
All right, then. Oh, bye-bye.
Okay, thank you. Bye-bye. Mm-hmm.
Praise the living God. Okay, 0570. Okay. All right. 057. Hi, you calling in for a session?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, what's your first name and the state you're calling from?
First name is Shirley. I'm calling from Florida.
Y'all getting a lot of Florida, right? Florida. I had a young lady from Miami, I think it was last Saturday, that requested to come and have hands laid upon her. And I scheduled a deliverance session meeting with her because she wanted hands laid upon her, and God set her totally, totally free. Okay, Shirley, what is it you're expecting the Lord to do?
I need deliverance.
Okay. What's going on with you that lets you see that you need deliverance?
I just feel like I went through a really bad breakup, and at the same time, I just was going through a lot. I feel like I've lost myself, but in addition to that, I've always felt like I had this anger problem, and I just feel lost, and I'm not happy. I have been just going through life, you know, and I feel like I'm not living. I don't want to live, and I know that that's not what God has for me. So I don't know. I've been going to all the wrong places. I've been going to psychics. I've spent so much money because they're telling me that something's wrong with me, and I have all these things, and I'm tired, and I need help.
What's your age? You sound really young.
No, I'm 37.
You know, you sound like you should be about 21. Oh, like a little kid, 21-year-old child, 37. Okay, Shirley. Have you seen the spirit husband? There's a demon in the spirit realm that say it's your husband. It's your spirit lover. It's a spirit lover. Have you seen it physically or in the dreams? A man coming to you?
I don't know if I've seen him in dreams. I've had like some really, that's another thing. I have like some crazy dreams that happen sometimes. And but I know I have one because I watch your video. I know I have one. I listened to your deliverance, but I just felt like I needed a more one-on-one conversation with you.
Right.
But
did the Holy Spirit bring your remembrance the molestation? Because that's when that you were espoused to that spirit lover, a molestation took place. What happened?
When I was younger, we had this lady. She just started really doing a lot of things, like inappropriate things in front of me and my sister. And I think that's when I really, it wasn't really that she touched me or anything.
Right,
it was just the inappropriateness. And it was something that like once I watched it, and that was mm-hmm. the first thought that came to mind was mm-hmm. that situation.
That's what
and
it was.
And it was so, yeah, and it was so funny because my younger sister, it was me and my younger sister, she recently was like, I know I have a spirit husband. She went and started praying, and she's like, I got rid of him. And it's like I started thinking about it's three of us, the second one. Me and her have been experiencing that, but not the younger one. So that all that started coming to mind when I was listening to the deliverance. I was like, that's why my younger sister never really had these sexual and inappropriate things. To her, it was always weird when we talked to her about it. But with my other sister, we understood, and that's because we were going through the same thing because we got exposed to it at the same time.
Mm-mm. So you and the other sister, one of your sisters, got exposed at the same time.
Yes.
Okay.
And now so
okay, go ahead. You can go ahead.
No, I was just going to say, like, when I try to explain it to her, the one that experienced it with me, like, we relate because mm-hmm. we went through the same thing. We got exposed to it at the same time. And then there was another situation where I had a cousin. I don't know if anything really happened, but I know that for my entire life, I just always felt like something happened. And I blocked it out because I was in shock because all I remember is going into the room, he was there, and then I walked out. And ever since then, I don't talk to him. I don't communicate with him. Like, I've always felt like something happened, but I'm not for sure.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And how old were you?
I couldn't have been any older than, like, 8.
Mm-hmm.
Maybe 10.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
But I was younger than, like 11 or 12.
Also, why did that other sister think that she got rid of that spirit husband? Why did she think that? Did she tell
because
you why?
Because she went through a deliverance mm-hmm. online. She found a deliverance online and she said that, you know, after she went through it, she said she didn't, you know, she was like, I don't feel him anymore. For her, the situation with her, it's almost like she's more sensitive to that kind of stuff. So she felt him more, you know, like she used to experience things where when she was in college, like she'll just feel like she was stuck and frozen and she's seen like a black object, you know, come down and lay on top of her. Like, she's experienced all of that. And it's like, she's telling me, she's like, I don't feel it anymore. She's like, I don't have sex in my dreams anymore. But for me, I don't have sex in my dreams, but I just have an unnatural sexual urge that I've been trying to fight.
Well, God gonna set you free, Shirley. And if he set you free, tell your sister, Evangeline King said, that spirit's not going anywhere. It's deceiving her.
Mm-hmm.
And what the Lord going to also teach you is that you receive what he's going to do by faith. You don't receive as your evidence that God delivered you from a spirit husband that you don't have sex in the dream or you don't feel it anymore. That's not the evidence that you have been set free. If that is your evidence that you've been set free, then that means that spirit ain't going nowhere because he always used that open door to come back into your life because it knows all it just need to do is just to be quiet and you will never know that it's in there because you're basing as your evidence on your feelings. And that's dangerous. That's an open door for them not to go anywhere and an open door for them to come back. Again, it's by faith. Because God would deliver you, and tonight you could still have a sexual dream. So when you wake up, it's your choice to choose. If you believe God's word by faith that he did set you free, or you believe by your feeling that he did not, that choice is yours. The devil always works with our senses. He knows we are human beings who love to walk by sight and go by what we feel. But when it comes down to the things of God, we don't walk by sight and we don't go by what we feel. We go by what we know, our faith in God's word, that he said, whatever I bind, whatever I loose, that means his anointed appointed servant on this earth, when they bind and loose, he is the one in the heavens who will be binding and loosing. I choose to believe those words because I know he cannot lie. So it's based on God's truth that when I speak, God's will to be done on earth as it is in heaven, he does it. It's not based on how I feel. It's not based on what I see or what I dream at night. That's not the evidence of my faith, my trust in God. You understand? So that demon is deceiving and fooling your sister. That thing is in there hiding. Now, it may not be manifesting its presence the way it manifests its presence with you and your other sister through and by the dream or the feeling. But you can cool believe that thing has shown some evidence that it's in her life and she ain't told you. She haven't told you. No. These spirits got to be confronted by a servant of God. It's not something that you can go over the internet and read and you read and say, I'm free. No. When it comes down to the strong man, that's where you need God through his human helper to join their faith with your faith and casting that thing out of you. Because God had delegated his authority to his body, church, those who have his spirit in them on this earth to cast devils out of human being body and in their soul. That's the only way Jesus cast spirits out. It's through his anointed and appointed servant. It's not something that you go on the internet and read and say, you know, I read this self-deliverance prayer and I'm now delivered. No, you know, that may be the little demons. Now, the stronghold have little servants, those little demons that's under their command. Now, they may go, but not that strong man. So that strong man going to have to be confronted. So you tell her, she want to hear more about it, tell her to call. That thing is deceiving. It's deceiving her. And another way of knowing is when she, if indeed truthfully that God has set her totally free, when she came to you and gave you that information, there'll be so much excitement in her and said, Jesus set me free. She wouldn't say, I got rid of that, because she can't get rid of. This is something Jesus have to do. If the Holy Ghost indeed deliver her from that spirit husband, when she would have told you, Shirley, she would have said, Jesus set me free from that spirit. And he can set you free. She would say something along that line. She wouldn't say, I got rid of that thing. I got rid of it. Because we can't. We can't get rid of it. We powerless. It's going to take Jesus. So that's hint number one, that thing is still in her, lying to her. And again, there have been some type of evidence that reflect that spirit is still in her and she haven't told anybody. So you make sure you share that with her. And also your other sister, too, needs to be delivered from that same spirit. Okay?
Yes.
But a person, praise God, that you humble yourself. It first starts with humility. You must confess to your wrong. Humble yourself and confess to your wrongdoing. Confess to Jesus, I need help. Something's in me. Something is hindering me from completely serving you truthfully and spiritually, Lord. Deliver me. And when a person comes to the Lord with humility, he would do that. But if you have pride and say, I don't need deliver, I'm already delivered, God's not going to help. And besides, if you are already delivered, again, it's all in the attitude. Your attitude would be, praise be to God. He had delivered me from that same spirit. He delivered me, and he will deliver you. Are you getting what I'm saying, Shirley? Can you sense the difference between humility and pride? Pride always say, I. Humility say, the Lord Jesus, deliver me. The Lord Jesus, help me. This will help you to know a difference when the Holy Spirit has indeed helped the person or not. It will be all in the attitude. The person will be humble about it or arrogant. Arrogant, again, I always say, I. Humility say, the Lord Jesus Christ. So, yes, your sister, both of them need to be delivered. But praise God, again, that you have humbled yourself and confessed to the Lord, Lord, I can't do anything, but you can deliver me. Anything, just like David, anything on the inside of me that shouldn't be, rid me from it. Now, God hears a humble person's heart, but the proud, he resists. Okay? So what I'm going to do, Shirley, I'm going to pray for you. Speak this disconnection. The relationships in the natural realm that you got to be disconnected from, and the relationship in the spirit realm you got to be disconnected from. Now, after your deliverance, you keep your mind stayed on God. The relationship that you need to develop is your relationship with God. That's the foremost important relationship you need to work on. And when you build upon that relationship, it is God who will determine the relationship to connect you to in this natural realm. You done did all the connection, all these many years. You see, there was a bad connection. No connection just don't work out. Those connection takes you farther away from God and put you closer or deepen you deeper into the kingdom of darkness. That's the reason why in that kingdom of darkness you met up with suicide. That's a demon spirit. Anger is a demon spirit. Depression is a demon spirit. All of these are demon spirits that you met up with as you was going deeper into that kingdom of darkness. All because you have taken your eyes off Jesus Christ and given him the care in regards to relationship, a earthly relationship. You have to give God that, because the most important relationship you need to develop and work on is your relationship with God. That's the only relationship that can keep you happy and peaceful on the inside. Okay?
Yes.
So you make sure, you know, you don't be connecting yourself to any relationship. If even though you might not be seeing this guy, but if you're still calling yourself dating, you have to disconnect from that relationship, because it's not a healthy relationship. God did not connect you to him. Any relationship that God did not connect us to, we must disconnect. We must disconnect. And failure in disconnecting from such relationships always keep us connected to the kingdom of darkness, because that is the spirit in which they are in obedience to. And light have no fellowship with darkness, and vice versa. So as children of God, we have to watch our relationships, because Satan do enter in a person through unhealthy relationships. So I'm going to go ahead and pray now. So Father, in Jesus' name, I thank you for your daughter. It's your will, Father, that she worship you truthfully and spiritually. Father, I thank you that every plan, every purpose, every ideal that you have in her life to take place and bring only glory to your son, Jesus, it shall come to pass. I thank you, Father, for keeping her to the day of redemption, setting your hedge of protection around her, Father. Keep her, Father. My heart cries out that you keep her. Thank you, Father. Opening up her eyes to see truth. Open up her ears to hear truth. Father, give her the gift of discerning the spirits, where she can see into the spirit realm, where she can see, just look at a person and see the spirit in whom they are in obedience to, Father. And then give her wisdom and knowledge and what you want her to do when that time comes in which she see, Father. Teach her your ways, Father. And I thank you, Father, for always being with her, Father. You never left her, and you never will. You was with her from demon spirit suicide. Tried to convince her to take her life, Father. You was right there, Father, to coach her and tell her, no, that is not my will for you. I thank you, Father, for you have great plans for her, and it shall come to pass. And I thank you, Father, for cleaning your house for true worship. Everything that's in her, Father, that is not of you, that you're not pleased of, I thank you for cleaning her, Father, and for keeping her, Father. Thank you, Father. Wherever she may go, I thank you for placing her into a protected bubble in which she is covered 24/7. I thank you, Father, for your plan, your purpose, your ideas being fulfilled in her life, Father, in Jesus' mighty name. Thank you, Father, for continuing to be with us on this conference line. I thank you, Father, because you say you never leave us, you never forsake us. And when two or three of us come together in your Son's name, you are right here with us. And whatever we bind and loose on this earth, Father, you the one who are binding and loosing in the heaven. So I take authority in the mighty name of Jesus. You spirit husband, come to attention, pack your load, and get out of God's house. Get out of his house. You get out of her mind. You get out of her will. You get out of her emotion. And you get out of her body now in the mighty name of Jesus. For the blood of Jesus have set her free. The blood of Jesus have forgiven her and her ancestors. The blood of Jesus disconnected her from all ungodly covenants of idolatry and even witchcraft. The blood of Jesus disconnected her. In the mighty name of Jesus, you have no legal right to reign in her mind, her will, her emotion, or her body. Holy Ghost, fire burn. Burn, Holy Spirit, from the crown of her head to the soles of her feet. Burn, Holy Spirit, burn all manner of darkness and evil that's lurking and hiding dormantly in her mind. Burn, Holy Spirit, burn everything in her mind that exalts itself against the knowledge of God. Burn, Holy Spirit, burn in Jesus' mighty name. Holy Ghost, fire, burn, 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 burn in her will. Burn all manner of darkness that's lurking and hiding dormantly in her will. Burn everything that exalts itself against the knowledge of God. Burn in her will. Burn, Holy Spirit. Holy Ghost, fire, burn in her emotion. Burn all manner of darkness that's lurking and hiding dormantly in her emotion. Burn, Holy Spirit. Burn all manner of darkness, every spirit that is exalting itself against the knowledge of God in her emotion. Burn, Holy Spirit, burn everything in her emotion that's not of you. Burn, 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 burn in Jesus' mighty name. Set her emotion, her mind, and her body ablaze, and her will ablaze in Jesus' mighty name. Holy Ghost, fire burn in her body. Burn all manner of darkness that's lurking and hiding in her body. Everything in her body that is not moving, walking, talking, sounding, or acting like you, that exalts itself against the knowledge of God, burn in her body, burn in her belly, burn all manner of snakes and eggs that are dormantly in her belly. Burn, 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 burn in her womb, burn in her private area, burn in her Philippian 2, burn in her uterus, burn, Holy Spirit, even burn up her nostrils, burn, Holy Spirit, burn all manner of darkness that's hiding in her nostrils, even in her eyes, burn, burn everything, Holy Spirit, that's looking through her eyes that is not of you, burn in her eyes, burn, burn in her eyes, burn everything, every vision, every image that was planted in her and through her eyes, burn, Holy Spirit, burn in Jesus' name, burn everything that's living in her eye that is not of you, Holy Spirit, burn, set her eyes ablaze in Jesus' mighty name. burn in her ears, burn everything in her ears, every negative word, every lie that had been spoken and traveled through her ears. Burn, Holy Spirit, burn in Jesus' mighty name. Burn in Jesus' mighty name. Holy Ghost fire continue to set her body ablaze. Burn, Holy Spirit. Burn every mark that is known or unknown to her on her body. Burn every hole that is illegal on and in her body. Burn, Holy Spirit. Burn in Jesus' mighty name. Give her body a complete flushing by your fire in the name of Jesus. By faith, I take the scissors of God and I cut and detaches her from that ungodly covenant of idolatry and witchcraft. The blood of Jesus forgiven her for that witchcraft. The blood of Jesus forgave her ancestors. The blood of Jesus washes that covenant away, that evil ungodly covenant. The blood of Jesus washes that contract away. The blood of Jesus destroys those cords. The blood of Jesus destroys the writings on them cords. The blood of Jesus destroys those lies. The blood of Jesus destroys those lies. At the root, he disconnect her from every spirit marriage in the spirit realm, every spirit family, every spirit child, every spirit husband, every spirit wife. In the name of Jesus, the blood of Jesus detaches her from that unhealthy, the ungodly relationship in the natural realm, even in the spirit realm. The blood of Jesus disconnected her. The blood of Jesus disconnects her. Father, dispatch your angels in the spirit realm. Gather every spirit that is not of you and send them where you desire to send them in the mighty name of Jesus. Surely, in Jesus' mighty name, you be free in your mind. You be free in your will, you be free in your emotions, and you be free in your body to serve and worship the Lord thy God, and him only would you serve in spirit and truth. Be free in Jesus' mighty name. Be free. Father, I ask you to fill her. Fill her with your spirit, Father. Fill her mind with your spirit. Fill her will with your spirit. Fill her emotion with your spirit and fill her body, Father, with your spirit in Jesus' mighty name. Thank you, Father, for setting this captive totally free. Thank you, Father, for even freeing her in her dreams, Father. Father, I ask you, anytime the enemy tried to inject his poison into her dream, wake her up, make her aware, Father, of the enemy plan, and give her wisdom and revelation in worshiping you in that situation. Father, I thank you for setting your daughter totally free in Jesus' mighty name. Now, Father, I pray. I pray for Shirley's house. Holy Ghost fire, go search and destroy at Shirley's house. Go in every room, Holy Spirit. Search and destroy all manner of thoughtness that's lurking and hiding in every room, in every closet. Go in every corner, crack, and crevice of the room. Burn by your fire the darkness. Burn, Holy Spirit. Go in every room. Go under the bed. Burn darkness. Go over and around the bed. Even go on top of the bed. Go between the sheets, between the mattresses. Burn, Holy Spirit, burn in Jesus' name. Don't leave no area at her house untouched by your mighty fire. Fire, the Holy Ghost, set her property completely ablaze in Jesus' mighty name. Even go outside the house. Burn around the house, under the house, over the house, even under the ground where evil objects have been planted. Burn all squatters that's on that property. Burn, Holy Spirit, burn everything that exalts itself against the knowledge of God. Burn, Holy Spirit, in Jesus' mighty name. Fill her home, her environment, Father, only with your spirit, Father, in Jesus' mighty name. Thank you, Father, in Jesus' name. Amen. Praise your holy name.
Amen.
Thank you, Jesus. Glory, glory, glory. It's done, Shirley. Now, you keep yourself pure and holy, and even your parents. Make sure your parents is pure and holy, okay?
Yes.
Make sure your appearance, when people look on you, they should see realness. There should be nothing that resembles false or fake on you. when they look at you, because the world can only go by what they see. So when they see you, they will see the appearance of God. So we have to watch how we dress. We have to watch our what we put on our entire body from head to toe. Don't be representing anything false, okay? Also, your clothes. Yes, in times past, before your delivery, you bought clothes, and you simply bought those clothes because you looked sexy in those clothes. That was not the Holy Spirit who told you to buy those clothes. That was Spirit Snake. Such clothes should never be worn. Those clothes need to be destroyed. Not given away, but destroyed. Okay, because darkness has saturated those clothes. Because the purpose of clothes are to allure and entrap people in lust. So therefore, those clothes are evil because they are saturated in darkness. Okay? But you are totally free. See, we women of God, we got to get back to what how the Lord told us to look and how the Lord told us to dress modestly. We want our outside to reflect who we are on the inside when it comes to our being a woman of God. We cannot call ourselves to be a woman of God on the inside, but the outside reflect that we are a worldly woman. So if we reflect on the outside that we are a worldly woman, it's only mean that we are worldly women on the inside. So when we are truly, truly free, truly set free, then we will reflect who we are on the inside, on the outside. So therefore, when a person look on us, whether male or female, who they will see is Jesus Christ. They'll see the glory of God upon us. And that's when the Lord say, if he be lifted up, he will draw men to himself. So if God is lifted up on the inside of us, and his presence radiates through us, so when people look on us, they are drawn to Jesus. They will literally see Jesus, and they will come and say, I see Jesus. When they look at you, but they're going to say, I see Jesus. Why? Because Jesus who is on the inside of us. Praise his holy name. So it's done. So again, you seek to build and know your relationship in Christ Jesus. So you are totally free. Again, how do you know you're free, Shirley? It's because you believe his word. Didn't you ask the Lord to free you?
Yes, I did.
You asked him. Do you believe that he heard you?
Yes.
And he did. So your evidence that you are free is based on your faith in his word, because he died for your freedom. That is his will for you on this earth, is for you to be free. He said, whatever we bind and loose on this earth, he bind and loose in him. So we bound those demon spirits and we cast them out at Jesus. Now Jesus is dealing with them. He done that. And how do we know? Because we believe his word. He cannot lie. So again, when the enemy tried to convince us using his illusion and trying to make us feel like he haven't left, or maybe show up in our dream that he haven't left, that is not the evidence that God set us free. That's Satan's lying illusion. So when you wake up, you rebuke his lying dreams. He said, I rebuke that dream. That is not God. God, I thank you for setting me free. I praise your holy name. I magnify you, Lord. And I thank you for keeping me until the day of redemption. I choose to keep my mind stayed on you. I choose to speak of your goodness. I choose you, Lord. And we have to praise the Lord like that. And as you praise the Lord like that, you are submit to God. And then Satan will run from you. And that thing, you don't forget about that lying dream. Because you know that Jesus set you free by faith in his word.
Yeah.
Amen. And long as you, Shirley, receive what God done for you by faith, Satan cannot take what God done away from you. He cannot take it away. He cannot. Regardless of how he tried throwing his illusion, he cannot, because you believe in your heart and you know in your heart that Jesus set you totally free. You just stay submit. And the only way Satan can come back, you must let him back in. You open the door. And how you open the door, you take your mind off the Lord. You turn your head away from the Lord. like Peter did when he looked at the Lord. He, as long as he looked at the Lord, he continued to walk on the water. But soon he believed Satan, lying illusion. He felt waves under his feet. He went by his feeling and not by his faith in God. He did not keep his eyes on Jesus so that he could keep believing Jesus. But no, he believed Satan, lying illusion. When that wave hit his foot, he took his eyes off Jesus and looked at the wave. And the moment he did that, he began to sink. But then Peter did a great thing. He realized and saw the error that he made, and he called on Jesus again. He called on Jesus again. And when he called on Jesus, he put his eyes back on Jesus, and Jesus lift them up, and Peter walked the water again, because he had to walk the water to get back on the boat. Jesus didn't pick him completely up and just pick him up and put him on the boat. No, Peter, Lord, touched his hand. He came up on the wave, and Peter literally with his feet, one foot being on the water and the other foot, he got in the boat. So you have to keep your mind stayed on him and don't believe Satan, lying, illusion. And you share. Shirley, you share what God have done. If you truly believe what God have done in this work he done for you, then whatever your heart believe, your mouth will speak. You tell, especially those two sisters, because God wants to set them totally free. And when you tell them, share with them, that choice is there if they want to obey or not. But you do your part by sharing what God have done for you. Okay?
Yes, I will. I wanted to ask you one thing. Mm-hmm. You said that I bought some clothes and you said for me to burn them?
I didn't say burn. I said every piece of garment that you bought, and you particularly bought it because you felt like you felt it made you feel or look sexy. That was the purpose of getting it.
Okay.
You felt and you looked sexy in it. That was not the Holy Spirit. That was Spirit Snape that worked in your feelings and your mind, who suggested you to buy such garments so that he would keep you bound in lust and also your lookers bound to lust. I said such clothes you cannot keep because it's soaked into evil. It's evil. Such clothes, you do not give them away, but you destroy them, you know. And I don't know where, you know, I don't know about the state of Florida, but here in North Carolina, we cannot burn things. So what you can do to make sure nobody ever wear those clothes is get you a pair of scissors and cut them where nobody, if they find the pieces, nobody can sew it back together, you know,
okay.
Get rid of it. Now, if you live in a place where you can burn things in a container, then you could do it that way. But I know North Carolina, we're not allowed to do that. I don't know about Florida. But the main thing is you cannot keep them. You have to get rid of the clothes, because if the Lord would open your spirit eyes, Shirley, you would actually see snakes going up and around, just crawling up and around those clothes. That's the reason why you see some, we're talking about women of God, because they are women of God. The world serves Satan. That's why some women of God, when you see them, they all walk the same. They got that same walk. They got that same look. That is Python. That is snake. That they want to feel and be sexy. That is Python. That is snake. That is not the Holy Spirit. Holy Spirit do not get us to dwell on feeling sexy. That's not of God. The Lord told us to be modest. Be modest. Okay, but you are totally, totally set free. Okay.
Thank you. Yes.
And also now, also if you have any pictures or keepsakes of anything in your house from former relationships, you need to get rid of it, because that's a connection. Those demons will not leave your house. Those are not connection from God. A lot of people don't believe it, but it's true. Demons gets in things. And when they in those things, then they'll end up coming out of things. And the thing you know, you start having paranormal activity in your home. And then the next step, they'll start tormenting you. So such things serves as a connection. It's evil. And you have to get rid of it. Because when you look at it, when you look at it, it don't cause you to think of Jesus no way. It puts your mind back on that relationship. In other words, Lord said that Satan used it as a trap to keep your mind from being on the Lord. So the best thing to do is get rid of it, regardless of how much it costs and regardless of what it is, you get rid of it. Now, that's if you want to build your relationship in Christ Jesus. You can't have it both ways. Okay?
Yes, ma'am.
So you do have some things that God had given you?
I just have pictures from the last relationship.
Yeah.
I'm going to get rid of them.
Yeah. You know, I pray, Lord, open you look at no picture, at least one of them. And Lord, open your spirit eyes and let you see the spirits that's truly in those photographs. You would be surprised. That happened to a couple of people after I ministered to. When they went back and looked at them photographs, they literally saw the spirits that was in those photographs. So I pray, Lord, let you at least see one of them, one photo where those spirits are in that photograph. Because they sure be in there. But you are totally free. Praise his holy name. So Shirley, now, as I was praying for you, what were you experiencing as I was praying?
I just felt, first I felt like a calm almost.
Mm-hmm.
And then I felt, like, especially when you're like Holy Ghost fire, I just started feeling warm, like, in my chest.
Mm-hmm.
Like I just felt that warm feeling, like I was feeling warm.
Mm-hmm. Amen. That's the Holy Ghost fire setting them things ablaze. Thank you, Lord Jesus, for the Holy Spirit. Thank you, Jesus.
Yes.
Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. He keeps us clean. Mm-hmm. Thank you, Father. Thank you. Glory. Now you know. Go ahead.
No, I was gonna say I really want to, you know, get a better relationship with him and to grow in him.
Mm-hmm.
Because I truly feel like before all of this happened, like he called me, he was calling me, and that's what started my walk with him.
Mm-hmm.
How do I move forward? Because I started reading the Bible. I have a study Bible. Like, what would you recommend that I do to, like, stay?
Continue to just devote yourself to him, consecrate yourself to him in his word. You know, when you read and study his word, the reason why you're doing it is so that you can know who he is. And so that you can grow by every word that comes out of his mouth. Just keep that fellowship. Don't stop. Just keep. Satan gonna bring in distraction, but you're gonna have to ignore his distraction and stay in that fellowship with him through his word. And see, as you spend time and devote yourself in God's word, but you don't realize that Jesus is right there. You are right there in his presence, and where Jesus' presence is. That's our anointing. The anointing is God's presence. So if you want the anointing, then you have to stay in fellowship with him through his word so that his presence can be right there. And see, where Jesus present is, we're going to be affected by his presence. That's how that thing works. Because I remember when I devoted myself to the Lord, when I devote myself now, but I must say then, you know, I was really, really, you know, devoted myself where I was just constantly in the word all the time, just constant. And because I was learning. And then I went to this church and the pastor had a man of God to come. And the Lord told me what he was going to have me to do. That's a long story. But to make it short, when I went up for prayer, the man of God looked at me and he said, "Pastor, this one is anointed." Well, I didn't know what anointed was. I never even heard of the word. And the pastor said, I know, but I don't want to admit to it. And I said, "Anointed? What he mean anointed?" So my mind went back to what I had been doing lately. And when my when now knew the Holy Spirit carried my mind back to what I was doing lately. And I said, oh, Lord, that's what anointed is. I said, oh, okay, well, I guess I'm anointed then. So what I had been doing, I consecrated myself where I just stayed in the study of the God's word, constantly in the study of God's word. So I said, Lord, so that's how you get anointed, by consecrating yourself and putting you first, foremost first over everything. I mean, Satan has sent distraction, trying to get me to come to this church for this reason, that reason. It was not godly. And I said, no, I'm not going. Y'all can go ahead. I'm not going. So I would just go in my little room, and I would just study and meditate over the word. That's what I was doing. So I said, Lord, that's how we get anointed. We have to stay in your word, and therefore, while us being in your word, that is your presence, and your presence gets all over and in us. Because a man of God said I was anointed. I didn't know what anointed was. But now I know, okay, Lord, that's how you get anointed. So that's how it is, Shirley. You got to consecrate yourself, you know, regardless of what. You have to deny the things that you like to do and just stay in his word, meditate. Friends want you to come this place and that place. No, I can't go. I got something to do. Because you get more joy out of being in his word, just fellowshipping in his word, you know, sacrificing. And that's what I did. So for those of you who tune in live and archives, you want to get anointed. That's how you get anointed by God. Lord just said, and that's how you get anointed by Satan. When you stay in the things of the devil, then Satan's presence is going to be there, and you're going to get anointed by Satan. That's why you catch some people who are so evil, because they're always in the presence of the devil doing devilish things. So that's what you do, Shirley, okay?
Okay.
Amen. Amen.
Amen.
And then when you do it, people look at you and say, something about her, she been in God's presence. Because there's no way that you can be in God's presence and nobody don't pick up on it. Somebody's going to, especially the devil, going to pick up on it because he can't come near you. I never forget talking about, man of God, this one is anointed. I'm like, anointed? What are you talking about? And the Holy Spirit took me back to what I was doing. I said, oh, that's what that is. I said, well, he right then. I'm anointed. Because that's what I've been doing. I said, oh, he's saying that I've been in God's presence. Because that's all I've been doing. I was just constantly gave up everything just in his prayer. Won't nothing just didn't excite me like being in God's word. Being with people who are excited about the things of God. You know, they wanted to go and do other things and felt like I should go. I said, no, I don't get joy. That's not my joy. And I wouldn't go. But I made sure I stayed in the word of God and just meditate upon him. And by doing so, God's presence was right there, and his anointing, which is his presence, was all over me, and the man of God picked up on it. And that's what a lot of people are safe whenever they talk to me or meet me, and that's because nothing don't give me pleasure but the things of God. And that's what you must do, Shirley, okay?
Yes, ma'am.
Amen. So you continue to stay submitted to him and just obey him. Obey every instruction that he gives you. You might not understand it, but he does it for your good. And later on, you'll understand that instruction. But in the meantime, you just be obedient. Regardless how the devil through other people tell you, you're foolish for believing the woman of God. It don't take all of that. Surely it takes all of that and more. It takes all of that and more, because we have to show the Lord that he's foremost in our life. Praise the living God. Okay? So you continue to stay blessed. Okay? Now, if you have any more questions, like I told the lady before you, just go to the website and send me an email. And as soon as I'm available, I'll respond to your email. Okay?
Okay, I will.
All right, then. Stay blessed.
Question. Okay. Thank you. Thank you
You're
so
welcome.
Much.
You're welcome. All right, then. Bye-bye.
All right. Bye-bye.
Praise God. Praise God, dear heart. Now remember, I have call-in deliverance sessions every Wednesday and Thursday at 2 p.m. Eastern Standard Time. You can call one number 720-820-1363. And if you're international, just go to the webpage freeconferencecall.com/wow/evangelistking and find your in-country dial-in number and enter SS code 335-950. Also, if you just want to listen to the live broadcast on Wednesday and Thursday, you call listener number 716-748-0762. You know, I sometimes do host weekend sessions, so just go to the freeconferencecall.com/wall/evangelistking. Look at the calendar, and it will show the next weekend date for a call-in deliverance session. So, dear heart, now remember, in all you're getting, be sure you get understanding. Shalom.